This is a review of the Nikkor 28-105 lens, and any lens in my collection has passed a few gates to make it, and the first gate is, can I afford it? And with $95 plus a little bit of import taxes, I can safely say, yes, I can afford this lens. Relative to what other lenses will set you back, this is a very, very low price. The second gate the lens has to pass is that it needs to have good reviews from those who actually own the lens today. And if we start out by looking at the image quality, and I give you here the condensed versions of all the reviews I've been through, and what they tell me is that it is sharp throughout the range, it has great color rendition as we know from Nikon, it has low distortion and a decent macro mode. On the not so good side, they say that it has dramatic chromatic aberration in some situations. I will show you an example of that a bit later. It's not the fastest, but I guess you saw that just from the specs on the lens. It has poor flare control, which most elderly lenses do, and there is some light fall off, but you can fix that again in post, so I don't consider these to be too big of an issue. All in all here, image quality, I would say that is a pass. If we move to usability, the feedback here is that it's lightweight, it's a good all-rounder, and it's basically a good walk-around or vacation lens. And I've seen that many times in the reviews that people say that this lens sits on their camera, you know, 70-80% of the time, because it really is a good all-rounder. On the negative side, they say that the autofocus is slow due to the gearing in the focus mechanism, the front lens is rotating when you zoom, and that can be a nuisance when you are using filters. It has a slim manual focus ring with a short throw, and the short throw I think is the biggest issue, because then it can be difficult to obtain focus. It assumes that the autofocus motor is built into the camera body, meaning that 3000 and 5000 series camera bodies from Nikon you cannot use with this lens unless you shoot in with manual focus. And then finally, and this is perhaps not fair to expect from a 20-year-old lens, but it's not weather sealed and there's no vibration reduction. That's what they report. So I would say, as I have a camera body with built-in autofocus motor, and autofocus is not too big an issue for me, I would say that this is a pass again, the usability. Finally, if we move to quality, made in Japan is always a good sign, right? And then there is a good blend of metal and plastic here that both keeps the weight down, but also, you know, makes it a good quality lens as such. But they also report that the sample variation is significant, so you need to make sure you get a good copy. So either test the lens before you buy, or make sure you can return the lens if your copy has an issue. And then finally, the mechanical quality is not up to the optical quality, especially the zoom. And I can confirm that when I unboxed my copy, I was really disappointed with the quality of the zoom. There's not much premium feel to that. It works, but it's not very premium. But after, you know, reading all these reviews, I think I can say that the second gate, this lens passed with flying colors, especially taking the price into consideration. The third and final gate I think any lens should pass is that it needs to fit into your lineup of lenses, or at least your plan for how you want to line up your lenses, how you want to build your collection of lenses, whether you're going for zooms or primes or a combination. This one, the 28-105, in relative to the normal way of building a zoom collection where you have the Holy Trinity that I'm showing you here on the screen, this one is a little bit an odd animal because it's a little bit too long in both ends to fit into this traditional way of building the Holy Trinity of lenses. However, I would say that having owned this lens for a few months, I'm surprised how versatile it actually is and how well the 28-105 actually covers many of your needs in terms of, you know, a general walk-around lens, a vacation lens or some also call it. Of course, you need to think about how this fits into your plans for your lens lineup, and this is very much in personal preference territory, so it's difficult to give some guidance. I will just say that I have been positively surprised by how many situations this lens is actually able to cover. So the lens passed these three gates and I made the decision to go ahead and buy a copy. And for the last 2 months or so, I've been shooting with this lens. It has been sitting on my Nikon D700 most of the time, and all the pictures you see here are shot exclusively with the Nikon D700. And I must say, I am absolutely impressed by this lens, especially when you take into consideration the price point. There is never a perfect lens, and this one has some issues, especially when it comes to chromatic aberration, and also the fact that there are variations between the copies of the lenses, so you need to make sure you get a good copy. But other than that, I will say I'm as happy as can be. Especially I enjoy the macro mode, where you can get really close to a flower. I know a macro expert will say this is not truly a macro lens, but for my use, I am really happy that it can switch between macro and non-macro, because this means I can leave my extension tubes at home. So for me, this is really a good jack-of-all-trades lens that sits on my camera, and I really enjoy that I can leave my extension tubes at home and I don't need to have a secondary lens in my bag other than a very wide lens for what I shoot. And as you can see, I shoot mainly landscapes, stills, flowers, that kind of thing. And if you're shooting something differently, you may end up with a different result, a different review. But I must say, I am really impressed by this lens, and it comes with my highest recommendations if you are in the market for a lens like this with a focal range between 28 and 105. So before you go ahead and buy your copy, I have three caveats, and the first one relates to chromatic aberration. And you can see here, this is a picture I've taken with a high contrast situation. You have the tree trunk here, and right to the left of that especially, you can almost, without zooming in, see that there is a blue line here. And if I go 4:1, you will see that, right, that is bad. Doesn't look good, does it? Then you're thinking, okay, I can just go into development module or development mode here in Lightroom and then ask for removal of chromatic aberration. But actually nothing happens. And the same goes for Photoshop. And even if I go into the RAW tool in Photoshop, it doesn't work. You have to download the Capture NXT software from Nikon in order to remove this issue. And I can just show you here. I've done that and gone into that tool. And here you can see now the problem is gone. It is somewhat cumbersome if you ask me, and it would be better, of course, if the lens did not have this chromatic aberration issue. I do think, though, that it is only in special situations this occurs. For most of my pictures, this is not an issue, but I just wanted to bring to your attention that there is sometimes chromatic aberration issues with this lens, and I'm not entirely sure it has to do with my copy. I think it is also a design issue. So if you can test your lens for chromatic aberration before you buy it, I would highly recommend that you do so. The second caveat, which is actually a recommendation, is that you use this lens together with a camera body that has the autofocus motor built into it. In my opinion, this makes life so much easier that you have the availability of autofocus. You can always switch it off, as I'm showing you here, by changing a little switch on the camera body if you want to go for manual mode. But I really enjoy the comfort of autofocus, and hence have to stay clear of the 3000 and 5000 series Nikon camera bodies. The third and final caveat relates to getting a good copy. And number one is if you can test the lens before you buy. And if that is not possible, then at least make sure you understand how you can return the goods. Make sure that if you buy on eBay or Amazon, that you can return the goods so that if you get a bad copy, you can return it to seller. Of course, there are some transportation costs involved in that, but at least it is better than standing there with a almost $100 lens that you cannot use. So to wrap up and conclude here, I think this lens has crazy value for money. It is a really good general purpose lens. There are some issues with chromatic aberration, but only in some cases. And if you're willing to extend your workflow, you can actually solve that issue. It comes with autofocus, but only via the camera body. So make sure you have a camera body that has the autofocus. And also make sure you get a good copy, either test before you buy or make sure you can return the lens, because there are some bad copies out there. That is actually my sort of conclusion and wrap up. And if you ask me if I can recommend this lens, it is a very big yes. But remember the caveats that I have given you, especially that you will make sure to get a good copy. If you're curious how this lens performs at various apertures, how it stands up against the Fujifilm 55-200, or how it stands up against the Nikon 35-70, then you can watch the rest of the video where I show you how I have tested this. If you're just after the conclusions, thank you for watching. As always, happy shooting. Take care. Bye bye. So just to test this lens at different apertures, I shot 5 shots, as you can see here, of a whiteboard with some dollar bills and a euro note as well. The only correction I did was I hit the auto button over here in Lightroom, and then I enabled profile correction. So you can see here, shooting at f4, the lens has a lot of light fall off or vignetting. But that is easy to fix, just hitting enable profile corrections. And I guess if you're using this lens, that's what you will do. So I thought it would be fair to switch that on. Other than that, I haven't really done much to these pictures. So let's see how it performs. The first picture is shot at f4.5. The next one 5.6, next one again 7.1, then 10, and finally 14. So if we just look at the first two and see how big a difference there is between fully open and then 5.6. So here, looking at the pictures shot at 4.5 and 5.6, if we take the center sharpness for starters, I'd say that it's a close call. Maybe the micro contrast here on the 5.6 is a little bit better, but I would say it's very close. Top left, again, very close, maybe slightly better with 5.6. If we look at the euro note, contrast here slightly better, but still I would say the bricks and the wall very, very well defined. And going bottom right, I know it says 83 here. I think it's difficult to read in both cases. And top right, what have we there? I think it looks very much the same. So, you know, shooting at 4.5 and 5.6, I'd say I'm pretty impressed by this lens. There isn't that much of a difference. If we then try and compare 4.5 with 10, then I would expect to see some major differences. So let's go in and look at the center here. And center-wise, I'd say maybe the contrast here is a little bit better with 10, but I'm surprised actually how well, again, the 4.5 does. Let's try the corners and see what's the difference. Yeah, maybe this is actually a tad sharper and better contrast. Let's go down and have a look at the euro note. And here I think the number you can see to the left is not as sharp as it is to the right. And let me just, yeah, again, the contrast here in the euro sign is much better. And let's take the bottom right, see if, yeah, I think it's difficult to see. It says 83 in both cases, actually. So I'd say I'm impressed with this lens. Obviously, you know, if you shoot at f10, you get a more contrasty and sharp picture than 4.5. But at 4.5, it is doing pretty impressive. So just for the fun of it, I decided also to take a picture with the Fujifilm X-T3 that I have. I have their zoom lens that is 55-200, and I shot at f4.5 just to see how they compared. And if you go and look at this, then I'd say the Fujifilm is definitely sharper. And if we go and look at the top left, I'm surprised actually to see the opposite, because now you have the Fujifilm to the right. Now the Fujifilm, to me, looks like it is softer. I don't know if you would agree, but I definitely think it looks like it's softer. Go down to the bottom left and look. Again, I have to align these a little bit. Hang on. I say here the Fujifilm has better contrast for sure. But still, the resolution is okay with the Nikon as well. And then go to the bottom right. See if you can see it says 83 anywhere here. Yeah, clearly the Fujifilm is sharper here. I think that the Nikon lens actually does a good job here, but clearly the Fujifilm has the upper hand here. However, people get mad at me when I say this, but we're shooting at f4.5 and f4.5. And people don't believe me when I say this, but you should actually apply the crop factor also to the aperture, not only to the focal length when you're shooting with an APS-C camera as the Fujifilm is. And that means we should compare the Fujifilm 4.5 to the Nikon around 7. And let's just give that a try. That could be interesting. Provided, of course, that you believe me. So this was at 7. So let's give those two a compare and just see how they stack up. And all of a sudden, it's a much more close draw or close race. There is some, I think this is chromatic aberration here on the Nikon side. And this is, I've had some other pictures where this has actually been an issue. But otherwise, I would say the Nikon is holding up pretty good. And if we go top left, I would say the Nikon clearly wins. No doubt about that. And if we go look at the Euro note here, I say it's a close draw. Close draw. It's a draw. Yeah. I don't know what you think. There also is a number down here. We can go have a look at that. This number here. I would say that's very, very, very close. Let's take a look top right and see what happens up there. Again, I would say the Nikon looks like it is winning. So if you believe what I say, that you have to apply the crop factor to the aperture, meaning that this is actually, this is not shot at 4.5, but this is more close to 7, and this is not 55 millimeters, that is more close to 80 millimeters, then you will be quite impressed by the performance of this lens, because I think actually, if it doesn't beat the modern lens, then it's right up there with it, I would say. Of course, a little bit of mess to compare APS-C and full frame, but those were the lenses and the cameras I had available. So maybe more relevant than looking at how it performs towards a Fujifilm lens, let's look at how it performs towards another Nikkor lens. And you can see here to the right, I have the 35-70 f2.8, and I've shot that at f7, and the same with the 28-105. The focal length, I did not manage to match that, but at least we are out of the extremes zone here. So it's sort of middle of the road here in focal length and middle of the road in terms of aperture. These should be easy to compare. And I was surprised to see that this 35-70 actually is less sharp than the 28-105. And especially if you look at the pillar, so this is the center sharpness we're looking at here. You can see up here where we are in the picture. The vertical lines here on the pillars, they are much, much sharper on the 28-105. If we go to the sharpness here top left, sorry, I just have to unlock these. They won't align completely, but here you are. I would say it's a draw, but I would still say the 28-105 has the edge here. And then if we go down to the Euro note here and look at the Euro sign here, how they're holding up, I think it's more close to a draw, if you ask me. But still, I think the 28-105, it's doing slightly better, if you ask me. Okay, I would say that is a draw as well. And if we go bottom right, maybe actually the 35-70 has a little bit better here, but it isn't much. The 05s here, they are a little bit better, if you ask me. Finally, if I'm in the top right, I would say the yellow parts here on the 35-70 is better than it is on the 28-105. But overall, I would say that, especially when you look at the center sharpness, the 28-105 is doing great. Mind you, this lens over here, the 35-70, it is more heavy, it is more expensive. It doesn't cover as much focal range. Maybe I should consider selling my 35-70 after seeing this. Yeah, food for thought.